Good evening, this is Pastor Shea from M.I.C. Church. Today we're going to be talking about part three of how to discern the voice of God. But we'll just wait for people to get started and for people to join us on this live broadcast. So we're going to wait a little bit longer before we get started. But in the meantime, what I would like to do is to type in our major text into the chat box. And that's where we're going to be starting from today. So we're going to be reading from the book of John chapter 10. Verse 27, because last week I talked to you about the fact that as long as you're a child of God, as long as you're born again Christian, whether you're born again Christian or not, you can hear the voice of God. The issue is not whether you can hear the voice of God, you can hear the voice of God. The question and the challenge a lot of us have is that we've not learned to discern His voice. God is always speaking to you every single day. Every single day He speaks to you. But the reason why you're not being able to, or you haven't been able to really confidently discern His voice is not because He's not speaking, it's because you have things in your mind or things in your life that are distracting you from being able to discern His voice. And also, if you've not learned to discern the voice of God, it can become quite tricky to discern His voice because you're hearing different things every single day. Sometimes the voice of your mind, sometimes your own personal desires, sometimes it's your experiences, sometimes it's just your concerns and your anxiety and your worries and your trials and your challenges that are getting in the way of you hearing the voice of God. But I want to convince you and I want to give you that confidence that you can hear the voice of God. Please understand, you cannot have a father, you cannot have a brother, you cannot have a sister, you cannot have a friend who God is like a brother, and He's your friend, He's your father, He's your lover. Well, it's not your lover, it's not your lover, it's your father, it's your brother, and He's your friend. And He wants a relationship with you. And because God wants a relationship with you, He has to be able to communicate with you. If God cannot speak to you and you cannot hear Him, then there is no relationship. What makes a relationship is the ability to communicate. One party speaks, the other party understands. One party speaks, the other party understands. And there's conversation, there's dialogue. Without dialogue, you have no relationship. So please understand this. God wants you to hear His voice. He wants you to hear His voice. But we need to get rid of all the distractions. Last week, I gave you two examples on how God speaks. We talked about the fact that God speaks through prophets. And we talked about the fact that God speaks through the word of knowledge. So what I want us to do now before we get into the teaching of today is to recap on what we spoke about last week. We spoke about the word of knowledge. For example, Peter knew who Jesus Christ was. Jesus asked him, "Who do men say that I am?" And he said, "You are the Son of the living God." And Jesus then turned around and said to him, "Flesh and bone did not reveal that to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Now notice this. When Jesus said that to him, the flesh and bone did not reveal that to you. What was he talking about? It's basically saying, this did not come from your own comprehension. This did not come from your own study of me. This came by divine revelation. God revealed who I am to you. And how did God reveal that to Peter? God did not speak to Peter in an audible voice. God did not send an angel. God downloaded it into his spirit through what we call a word of knowledge. God downloaded it into his mind, rather, sorry, through what we call a word of knowledge. Now, as you all know, word of knowledge is when you just know that you know that you know. You don't know how you know, but you just know that you know. That is word of knowledge. And that's how Peter got to find out who Jesus Christ was. Now notice this. Yes, he was a disciple of Jesus. Yes, he was a follower of Jesus. But he did not really know who Jesus was. They knew him as a prophet. They knew him as the soon coming king. They knew him as somebody who proclaimed to be king. They knew him as somebody who said he's God. But on a heart level, they really did not genuinely weren't totally sold out to the idea of him being God or being the Messiah. They wondered, is it the Messiah? Is it the Messiah we've been waiting for? Is it, could it be? Could it be? Might be? Could it be? Might be? That's their mentality. And it's the reason why everybody else who gathered around Jesus were likening Jesus to Elijah. Some said you're Elijah. Some said you're Elisha. Why? Some said you were Jeremiah. Why? Because Elisha, Jeremiah, and Elijah, they did similar things. They healed people. They did miracles. Things that Jesus Christ was doing. So the only way they could really define Jesus was to define Jesus based on what he did, not on who he was. Now, to understand who Jesus was, they had to be in relationship with him. And because most of the crowd that followed Jesus were just followers of Jesus. They were following Jesus for the things that he did or for the things they believe they can get from Jesus. But they did not really have an intimate relationship with him like the disciples did. Now, here's the funny thing. Even though the disciples had an intimate relationship with Jesus, they didn't have that revelation of who he truly was. They had an idea of who he might be or who they think he is, but they weren't sold out completely of who he was until Jesus asked him that question. And obviously, God revealed that to Peter. And God gave him a word of knowledge whereby he knew beyond questionable doubt that this was the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Hence the reason why Jesus turned around and marveled. It was completely, you know, really amazed by the revelation that Peter came up with. And that's why he turned around and said, you know, flesh and bone do not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And then he said, upon this rock I will build my church. Meaning upon this revelation that you've received, I will build my church. Meaning the church of God is built on revelation. It's not built on man. It's not built on miracles. It's not built on tithes and offerings. It's not built on doing good works. It's built on revelation. Now, what is revelation? Revelation is nothing but progressive theology. Progressive theology. Revelation is nothing but progressive theology. And Jesus said, upon this rock, I will build my church. Meaning upon this revelation that you've received, I will build my church. So the Christian walk and church growth, Christian work in general, is built upon revelation. And revelation is progressive. And revelation can be static. If you don't get closer to God, you cannot get to know more of God. And the closer you get to God, the more you discover about God, the more you get to know how God works, the more you get to understand how God thinks, the more you get to understand how what pleases him and what doesn't please him, the more you get to understand how he speaks and the ways and manners in which he speaks. But you must work on that relationship. Just like if you have a husband or you have a wife, you get to know your wife or your husband a little bit better by spending time with them, by talking to them, by having conversations with them, by doing things together. It's in that intimacy of doing things together, talking together, that you get to understand them a little bit better. And the time will come whereby they don't have to say something before you know exactly how they feel. And that is the same with God. Just because you cannot see God with your naked eye, that doesn't mean God is not a personality. God has a personality. Yes, God is a spirit. He has a personality. And he wants a relationship with you because that is the only way you're going to get to know him. So when we're talking about discerning the voice of God, it's virtually impossible to be able to discern the voice of God unless you have a relationship with him. Now, the biggest struggle in the body of Christ is that people doubt whether they can hear the voice of God. I've spoken to countless of Christians and I've counseled countless of Christians, and this is the same problem I face day in, day out. How do I know God speaks to me? How can I get God to speak to me? But I want you to understand, if you're born again Christian, God 100% speaks to you. Even a non-born again Christian hears the voice of God, but they cannot discern the voice of God because they don't have a relationship with God. But if you're born again Christian, you can discern the voice of God. Why? Because you have a relationship with God. But the Christian who's born again, the reason why they struggle to discern the voice of God is because they've not been trained to have a listening ear. You need to be trained to have a listening ear. One of the biggest things this is one of the biggest skills I believe a Christian must learn to have and consistently develop is the ability to hear the voice of God. Do you know why? Because you are one breakthrough. You are one voice of God away from your breakthrough. You are one voice of God away from the solution to the problem that you face. You are one voice of God away from the answer to the prayer that you've asked for. You are one voice of God away from knowing what to do at any given point in time. But if you cannot hear the voice of God, how can you receive knowledge from God? The Bible says in the book of Hosea 4 verse 6, my people perish due to what? Lack of knowledge. Knowledge is what makes people perish. Meaning, you are not where you should be. You're not achieving the things you should achieve. You're limited in your life because of lack of knowledge. I want to say this again. As a born-again Christian, you hear the voice of God. I don't care what anybody has told you. I don't care what books you've read. I don't care what church you've been to. I don't care what anybody has told you. I want you to understand this. If you are a born-again Christian, you 100% hear the voice of God. It's not a case of whether you might or when you, will you hear the voice of God. If you are a born-again Christian, by definition of you being a born-again Christian, you hear the voice of God. Now, like I said to you just now, somebody who's not a born-again Christian hears the voice of God. You who are a born-again Christian hear the voice of God. So what is the difference between somebody who's born again who hears the voice of God and somebody who's not born again who hears the voice of God? I'll tell you what the difference is. Somebody who's not born again can hear the voice of God, but they cannot discern the voice of God. Somebody who's born again can hear the voice of God, but can struggle to discern that this is the voice of God. Why? Because if you are married, for example, and you have a husband, or you're married and you have a wife, and your wife was to speak to you from the kitchen and you're upstairs in the lounge, you can discern and you can hear a voice. Now, why would you be able to hear the voice of your wife or husband, even though they're downstairs in the kitchen or downstairs in the pavement? Because you are in relationship with them. You can hear the voice of your spouse because you are in relationship with them. You can discern the voice of your spouse because you are in relationship with them. And the same thing applies to God. Just because you cannot see God with your two naked eyes, or natural eyes, should I say, that doesn't mean you cannot hear his voice. You can 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 hear his voice. But you might struggle to discern his voice if you're not in relationship with God. That is why the Christian journey starts with relationship. You must be in a relationship with God to hear his voice. You must be in a relationship with God to discern his voice. A non-Christian who is not saved can hear the voice of God. And how do I know that? Because you and I, once upon a time, we weren't saved. But we heard the voice of God and we gave our life to Christ. Now, you might argue and say, but I did not hear the voice of God. I heard a pastor preach the message, or I heard somebody preach the message. Let me tell you something right now. The word of God is the voice of God. The word of God is the will of God. The will of God is the voice of God. So whether you heard a sermon, whether you heard an evangelist, whether somebody else or friend or family member spoke the word of God to you that led to your transformation, led to you giving your life to God, it doesn't matter what medium that message came from. The Bible tells us that the word of God is a spirit. It's alive and it's active. So it doesn't matter whether the word of God came from a preacher. Does not matter whether the word of God came from a prophet. Does not matter whether the word of God came from a donkey. Does not matter whether the word of God came from your mom. Does not matter whether the word of God came from your enemy. As long as what is spoken is the word, you just heard the voice of God. So the issue here is no longer whether can you hear the voice of God. Every human being can hear the voice of God. The challenge is discerning his voice. Let me invite you tonight to this message. I want to encourage you to take a lot of notes, because what I'm about to share with you is life-changing. For the past few weeks, we've been specializing in this topic, covering different areas and different ways in which God speaks. And I'm going to share another two different ways in which God speaks with you tonight, so that you can have a broad sense of how God can speak to you. Sometimes people tell me, oh, God speaks to me in dreams. So they're constantly waiting for God to speak to them about anything they're asking God for in a dream. Can God do that? Yes, he might do that. But that does not mean he's going to speak to you in a dream again, because he spoke to you in a dream last week or last month or last year. You feel for you to hear the voice of God, you must go to bed and sleep. No. Yes, God can choose to speak to you in a dream. But the key to the Christian life is this. Don't limit God. Remember, God is God Almighty, not God Almighty. God is not our mate. He's not my mate, neither is he your mate. He's God Almighty, not God Almighty. So what you need to understand is this. Yes, God can speak to you in a dream. And if that's how God has been speaking to you, that's all well and good. But don't get used to that. Why? Because we serve a progressive God. God would not want to limit you to one way in which he speaks when he has several ways in which he speaks. Why do I say that? Because if God has different ways of speaking to his children, he wants you to learn the different ways on how he speaks, so that whenever he speaks or however he chooses to speak, you won't miss it. So I want to encourage you tonight to keep your heart open. And I want to encourage you tonight that even if you felt like, I don't hear God, God doesn't speak to me, I want you to understand this, that is a lie from the pit of hell. I can confidently tell you, and I'll prove it to you in scripture, that you hear the voice of God. The challenge is sometimes you just don't discern it as the voice of God. And the reason why you don't discern what you're hearing as the voice of God is because you've not trained yourself to have a listening ear. You've not trained yourself to discern his voice. A non-believer, like I said, can hear the voice of God, but they cannot discern the voice of God because they're not in relationship with God. A born-again believer can hear the voice of God, and if they're trained, they can discern the voice of God if they're in a relationship with God. Everything starts with relationship. So tonight, I'm going to share two other ways in which God speaks. So just to help you know when God's speaking to you. We've covered four already. This will be the two other different ways in which God speaks. There's 10 in total that I've discovered in the Bible and through my own personal experiences, but it's not limited to 10. God can speak in different ways, and he consistently speaks in different ways. But I've, in my Christian journey, my personal walk with God, and from studying the Word of God, I have found 10 ways in which God speaks. The past few weeks, I've covered four. Today, I'm going to cover two, and next week, I'm going to cover another two, and so on until we get to number 10. So today, I want you to start off by reminding you this truth. Not my opinion, it's a biblical truth. That as long as you're born again Christian, you hear his voice. Open your Bible to the book of John chapter 10, verse 27. John chapter 10, verse 27. And it reads, John chapter 10, verse 27 to 28. Please type that into the chat box, and so into the comment section, and please share this page with everybody. Please share this page with your friends. Please share this page with everybody you know, because I want people to really benefit from this teaching, because I learned this myself. I wasn't born with this knowledge. I learned it in time of prayer, in time of studying the Word. And if I didn't learn it, I would not be able to discern the voice of God. So people out there are crying and dying to hear the voice of God, because that is the greatest skill any believer can have, to learn to hear the voice of God. So please share this page. John chapter 10, verse 27 to 28. And it reads, my sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. Let's stop right there. Let's focus on verse 27. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. Now, let's stop right there. God is making an absolute statement. He said, my sheep hear my voice, meaning those who belong to me, those who are my children, those who are saved, those who are Christian, those who are believers, those who have given their life to me are my sheep. Because they're mine, they hear my voice. I know them, meaning I know who my sheep are, and they follow me. Now, have you realized something here? If you don't trust somebody, you will not be quick to listen to their advice or to take on their advice. If you don't trust somebody or you don't know somebody, you can't vouch for somebody, you'll be reluctant to follow them wherever they might want to lead you. Why? Because of trust. Now, where does trust come from, or how is trust created? Trust is basically created by virtue of relationship. You trust somebody either because you know that person, you know of that person, or somebody that you have a high level of trust and confidence in referred that person to you. So why would you follow somebody you have no trust in? That would be the most ridiculous thing to do. God is saying, my sheep hear my voice. Those who belong to me hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. Why would they follow him? Because they know him just like he knows them. And they trust him so they can follow him. The same example can be applied in the natural world. A shepherd looks after sheep. Now the sheep follow the shepherd. Sometimes the shepherd, all he has to do is just whistle and they know what to do. They follow him. Why? Because they've learned to discern the voice of the shepherd. And sheep, when you study the life of sheep, they will never lie down to grace unless they feel at peace, and they're easily rattled. Sheep are easily, they're animals that are easily rattled, but they will never lie down to grace on any land, no matter how beautiful, no matter how green the pastures are, if they're not at peace. And the reason why they will lie down is because they're at peace. And the reason why they're at peace is because they know who their shepherd is. They know their shepherd is there to protect them, to provide for them, not to harm them, not to hurt them. And they know that because the shepherd is around, they can be secure, they can lie and be at peace, because they know there's independent danger that is a threat to them. The shepherd would notice and it would sound the alarm for them to move on. That's why they can lie down and be at peace. Most other animals, when they're eating or look or trying to find some food to eat, they're always looking around. Even birds would fly and land. Have you noticed pigeons? When they're looking for food, they're always looking around to see if there's anybody coming. Why? Because they're not at peace. They're consistently watching their backs just in case there's danger around. But with sheep, they don't do that. Why don't they do that? Because they have a shepherd they trust. They know his voice, so they know when he blows the whistle, off they go. That is how God is. God is our shepherd. And when you are in a relationship with God, you have that trust, that confidence. The closer you get to God, the more trusting you will be of God. Because the closer you get to God, the more you will get to know him. And in getting to know God better, you can trust him more. Because you will struggle to trust God unless you get to know God. Not who you think God is, but who God is. A lot of people have an idea of who God is, but they don't really know who he is. When you get to a place in your Christian journey, or when you grow and mature on your walk with in your walk with God, and you get to really know God for who God is, not who you think it is, not who your mom said it is, not who the preacher said it is, but who you have gotten to know him to be, trust is developed. So when God speaks to you, you're quick to trust and obey. Because you know God is good, and only goodness can come out of God. Now, the reason why it's important to discern the voice of God is this. When God speaks, it's either instructing us to do something, encouraging us, reprimanding us, or helping us, or bringing in some form of announcement that is of benefit to us. That's why God speaks to us. It's a purpose for God. He just doesn't speak because he wants to speak. He wants to be involved in our life. He wants to be involved in your life. He wants to be involved in my life. And sometimes we're going on the wrong path, and God wants to tell us that, look, what that path you're heading is the wrong path. I want you to turn around. But a lot of times we don't hear because we've not learned to discern his voice. That is why it's crucially important that you learn to discern the voice of God. Please understand, God is all-knowing. He knows everything. So if you have somebody in your life who has all the answers, surely it makes sense to seek their counsel. Surely you want to listen to what they have to say, especially if they know the end from the beginning. A lot of times we run to friends asking for advice when we should run to the Maker, God the Father. Who is more important, the creation or the Creator? Let me say that again. Who is more important, the creation or the Creator? That is what you gotta ask yourself. This is why it's so important to learn to discern the voice of God. I can't stress this enough. A Christian life without the ability to discern the voice of God is a life that is being gambled away. You're gambling your life if you don't learn to discern the voice of God. Because God knows the answer. He knows the end from the beginning. And he can lead you. So that's why we're looking at this subject today. So I want to stress this again. If you are born again, you hear the voice of God. We've read that in John chapter 10, verse 27. That if you're born again, you are God's sheep. He knows you and you will follow him. He knows you. You hear his voice. He knows you and you will follow him. And the reason why you follow him is because you've learned to discern his voice. Those who struggle to follow the instruction of God is because most of the time they struggle to discern that's the voice of God. So now that we've established that, now every week when I talk about the voice of God or discerning the voice of God, I like to bring us back to this biblical truth that you hear the voice of God. so that the enemy cannot deceive you about that. Because if you believe you don't hear the voice of God, why would you want to learn? Why would you want to learn to discern it? You would not want to learn to discern to hear the voice of God if you don't believe you hear the voice of God. So now that we've established the fact that it's proven biblically, not just my opinion, it's a biblical fact that you hear the voice of God. Now let's look at the other two ways in which God speaks. Okay? So what I want us to do now is look at two other ways that God speaks. Because today I'm going to focus on just two extra ways in which God speaks to help us tonight. Now, before I do so, I want to start off by letting you know that God speaks through angels. Let me say that again. God speaks through angels. Now, in the Old Testament, God used angels a lot to speak to people. And the reason for that is because back in those days, people were living without the Holy Spirit. But under our dispensation, we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That's why several weeks ago, I covered the fact that God speaks through an inward witness. And that inward witness is the Holy Spirit speaking to us. You see, the Bible says when you're born again, what happens is this. Your spirit, i.e. your born again spirit, gets fused with the Holy Spirit of God. And when God speaks to the Holy Spirit speaks to you, and your born-again spirit speaks to you in the form of thoughts and impression. So our spirit is one with God when we get born again. So that's why primarily in under our dispensation of grace, God will speak to you more through his word and through an inward witness. Now, the reason is because God is a purposeful God. Now, does that mean God cannot send angels? Of course he can send angels, but why should he send an angel to tell you something that the Holy Spirit that's inside of you can already tell you? It would be pointless. That would be a pointless exercise to send an angel from heaven, even though an angel could appear in the blink of an eye. Yes, we know that, but why would he send an angel to tell you something the Holy Spirit already knows, that the Holy Spirit could minister to you? It would be counterproductive and counterintuitive. And we know that God is a purposeful God. So God speaks for an inward witness. But today, we're going to be looking at the two other ways in which God speaks. So the first one I want to talk to you about is the fact that God speaks through angels. Now, I'm sure you would love an angel to appear to you, even though you might be terrified, but you would love it. Let's open our Bible to the book of Luke chapter 1, verse 8 to 19. Now, please type that into the comment section. Luke chapter 1, verse 18 to 19. That's Luke chapter 1, verse 18 to 19. Please type that into the comment section. And it reads, "Now, while he was serving as priest before God, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled, and when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord, and he must not drink wine or strong drink. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared.' And Zechariah said to the angel, 'How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years.' And the angel answered him, 'I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I was sent.'" Let me say that again. "And I was sent." Let me say that again. "And I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news." Here we clearly see a classic example of God speaking through an angel. Zechariah was expecting a supernatural miracle for a child, but yet his mindset was focused on the natural. He was experiencing a supernatural encounter, i.e. an angel speaking to him, but his mind and hearts were stuck in the natural. Isn't that interesting? Sometimes God is speaking to us, but we're not hearing what God is saying because we are governed by our five senses, what we can see, what we can touch, what we can smell, what we can taste, what we can feel. But God was speaking to him right there. There's nothing as elaborate and shocking and so vivid than an angel. But yet Zechariah, despite the fact that he had a desire for a child, could not get past the fact that he was looking at himself, thinking, I'm old. How can I have a child? Can we have a child? I'm old. But God was telling him, I've heard your prayer. And I've sent the answer in the form of an angel to give you a word from me. So God was speaking to him through an angel to let him know that, number one, not only have I answered your prayer to give you a child, number two, not only will that come to pass, number three, I want to give you specific instruction on how you should train the child and what the child must not partake in. Very specific. But Zechariah was stuck in the natural. But the gist of all of this is this: God spoke through an angel. Now, clearly, as we read on, we'll see that obviously Zechariah was unable to talk because he had doubts and all of that. But I'm not going to go into that. But the key thing, the key point I want to draw out of this is that God spoke through an angel. Now, Zechariah was not just an average guy; he was a priest. We should know better. He knew the ways of God, but despite that, he was stuck in the natural. That just tells you that it doesn't matter how mature you might think you are in God, if you don't consistently cultivate your ability to hear the voice of God, if you don't consistently walk on your relationship with God, if you get complacent with your walk with God, if you allow the issues of life and the troubles and the challenges of life and the worries of life to cloud your judgment, you can miss God. You can miss God. Clearly, we saw that in the life of Zechariah, a priest. In the temple. It was not a home. Check this out. Zechariah was in the temple. God appeared to him and he missed God. God sent an angel. Think about it. If you see an angel, this is something. An angel is a supernatural being. Why on earth can you not perceive that this is God? That just goes to show you the human condition. The flesh is very weak. And if we don't train up ourselves spiritually, we can always... we that indirectly will be governed by our flesh. The Bible says what is the flesh goes with the flesh. And what is the spirit goes with the spirit. The Bible says those who are living in the flesh cannot please God. And those who walk in the flesh cannot please God. The Bible says walk in the spirit so you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. What is the lust of the flesh? The Bible tells us very clearly the lust of the flesh involves three things. Lust of the eyes, pride of life, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, pride of life. That is what is in the world we live in today. And that is what the flesh is drawn to. You know, what I can see, what I desire. If I can see it, then I know it's real. If I desire something and I see it, I believe it. Zechariah desired a child because he couldn't see it, he was struggling to believe it. But the Bible says, if we walk in the spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If we walk in the spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That means if you do not walk in the spirit, then you're bound to fulfill the lust of the flesh. Because if you walk in the spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh, which means if you do not walk in the spirit, you're bound to fulfill the lust of the flesh. So the question is, what do we want to govern our lives, the flesh or the spirit? If the flesh governs your life, if you allow the flesh to govern your life, I can tell you right now, you will always struggle to discern the voice of God. But if you allow the Spirit of God that's inside of you to govern your life, you will always discern the voice of God. Because what is spirit goes with spirit, what is flesh goes with flesh. And your spirit, your born again spirit, is fused and joined with God. So if you allow the Spirit of God that's joined with God to govern your life, you'll be able to discern the voice of God. Now, clearly we see in this example, God spoke through an angel, Zechariah missed it. So it is possible to experience the supernatural power of God, the supernatural presence of God, and miss it. I'll give another example. There's a scripture in the Bible that tells us about how there was a sudden earthquake, but God was not in it. There was fire, but God was not in it. But then came a still, small voice, and God was in that. a lot of the time we're expecting the grandiose, the supernatural, the miracles, the signs and wonders before we can believe God is speaking to us. Sometimes we're waiting for somebody to come and say, thus says the Lord, and you shall be with child, or this is going to happen to you, or we're waiting for prophecy before we believe God is speaking to us. But can God speak that way? Yes, and he can, and he does speak that way. But primarily, that is not how God speaks to you, even though he can speak to you that way. So the key emphasis here is to teach ourselves and to train ourselves not to limit God. Don't limit God on how he speaks to you. You see, hearing the voice of God is one thing. Discerning his voice is another thing. And learning the ways of God is another thing entirely. So as a Christian, we know you already hear the voice of God. So let's just leave that to one corner. So discerning the voice of God and learning how God speaks are of critical importance to your Christian journey. Because if you know how to discern the voice of God, that just means you can discern his voice. So whether God speaks through a microphone, whether God speaks in your dreams, whatever the case might be, you can discern it. And you will never be able to discern the voice of God if you're not aware of the ways in which God speaks. You will never be able to discern the voice of God if you're not aware in the ways in which God speaks. I'll give you an example. Right now, Choice FM is playing music, but I cannot hear it. Why? Not because they're not playing music. They are playing music right now. I cannot hear it because I am not tuned in. My receptors are not tuned in. My receiver, rather, is not tuned in. So, whose fault is it? Is it the fault of Choice FM? Is that the reason why I can't hear them? No, because I am not tuned in. But the moment I tune in, I can hear it. To be governed by the Spirit of God is to be tuned into the Spirit. And how do you get tuned into the Spirit? It's by cultivating a daily time with God. That could be in your quiet time. That could be daily reading of the Bible, daily praising God, spending time with God, talking to God. That could be your quiet time. That could be a solitude whereby you take a day or take 2 hours or take 3 hours alone to be with God. Whatever works for you. But the key important thing here is this. You must find time to spend time with God. Because it is in spending time with God that you learn to discern his voice, that you will learn the ways of God. The Bible talks about a man in the Bible. His name skipped my mind all of a sudden, but it talks about this man knew the ways of God. Yes, I remember now. The Bible said David knew the ways of God. David did not only know God, but he knew the ways of God. If you notice, when David faced Goliath, he said, the Lord will deliver your head to me today, Goliath. But that's interesting observation, because David was very specific. It said, God will deliver your head to me, Goliath, even though David did not know how to use a sword. So how on earth will he get the head of Goliath? Well, he had confidence that the battle is not his. He's not going to be the one fighting the battle. It's God that's going to fight the battle. And he said one thing very interesting, which gave me a better understanding of why he knew God was the one fighting the battle. He said this. He said, the God who saved me from the bear, the God who saved me from the lion, will also surely deliver your head to me, Goliath. So his confidence was not in his ability, because the Bible tells us clearly that David didn't know how to fight. He was not a man trained in the art of war. All he knew was to swing that little slingshot that he had. That's all he knew. And he used what he had. But think about it, a slingshot is not enough to take off a man's head, especially a giant. But supernaturally, God can do it. And David knew, I'm just a vessel, I'm just an instrument that's going to be used by God to accomplish the things that he, God, wants to accomplish through me, the vessel. And David understood that. Why? Because he understood the ways of God. And when God gave him the confidence to go forward to do what he had to do, which was to kill Goliath, he didn't question it, because he was able to discern the voice of God. He knew it was God leading him. He knew it was God directing him. And that gave him confidence. So you see, when you learn to discern the voice of God, it's not just about being able to hear what God is saying to you, but being able to discern the voice of God gives you that inner confidence that you need to act out and to obey what God has told you to do. Now, if you hear a voice in your head telling you to do ABC, and you're not quite sure where that voice is coming from, it's very, very hard to follow that instruction. It's very, very hard because sometimes when God speaks to you, he tells you to do things that will blow your mind. Why would it blow your mind? Because these are not things that you could even comprehend or even see how you can actually achieve those things. Look at Abraham, for example. God said, leave your land, go to a land I will show you. Now, just picture this. This is a man who has kids, a wife, who has responsibility, who has quite a lot of things going for him. God is saying, leave all those things and follow me. Not follow me to Canada, not follow me to America, not follow me to London, but follow me to an unknown land. Basically, I'm following you, God. I don't know where I'm going. I'm doing it by faith to a land I'm going to show you, the Bible says. That requires faith. Now, how on earth was he able to follow God if he did not only discern the voice of God, but understood the ways of God? Abraham knew that God's ways are not necessarily straightforward in the way that we determine what's straightforward or not. He knew God's ways can be confusing. He knew God's ways might seem awkward, but he knew God's ways was always the best. Hence the reason why he was able to follow. So the interesting point here is this. If Abraham did not have a relationship with God, number one, he would not have been able to discern the voice of God. Number two, there's no way he would have followed the instruction that God gave him. Just like when God told him to sacrifice Isaac, he knew something was going to happen. God has to do something because he knows God is not a God who's going to want to kill this child. But for some strange reason, God is asking him to do this. And he went ahead to do it because he had learned to discern the voice of God and he had learned the ways of God. So, as you can see from this example that I've given you so far in the life of Zechariah, God could speak through an angel. And God spoke to an angel through Zechariah, but Zechariah struggled to discern this was God. Hence the reason why he was asking for more proof. He was struggling to discern that this was God. Because if he had 100% accuracy, conviction that this was God, why would he question it? He wouldn't question it. So that's an example of Zechariah on how God used an angel to speak to him, but he struggled to discern the voice of God. I'm going to give you another example, which will help to bring this point to a close. Let's look at the life, let's look at the book of Luke chapter 1. Please type that in. Luke chapter 1 verse 26 to 38. Luke chapter 1 verse 26 to 38. Please make sure you type it into this comment section, please, and share in this page because I want everybody to really benefit from this teaching. Luke chapter 1 verse 26 to 38 and it reads, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greetings this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father, David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never know no end. Or his kingdom will never end, rather, sorry. How will this be? Mary asked the angel. Let's stop right there. We saw Zechariah said something very interesting in the previous scripture that I just read. Zechariah said, show me proof. I'm hearing what you said, that I'm going to have a child, but angel, Gabriel, show me proof. Here was a man who desired a supernatural intervention of God by giving him a child at his old age. And when God showed up, he wanted God to show him proof. Why? Because he was struggling to discern that this is God. Because if you believed that this was God, he would not be asking God for proof. If he fully understood the ways of God, he would not be asking God for proof. Yes, he was a priest, but yet he had a lot of growing up to do spiritually. He was asking God for proof. But here in this example, we see Mary, who was not a priest. Mary was not, had no title whatsoever, but she understood what was possible with God. She understood the ways of God. And she understood who God was. But more importantly, she was able to discern the voice of God. How do I know? Let's read on. She said, how, in verse 34, she said, how will this be? Mary asked the angel. So she's saying, how will this take place? She said, how will this take place? How will this be meaning? How will this take place? I know you can do it. I know you're going to do it. We already know that. I'm not asking the question to find out how you're going to do it, because I know you can do it. But I'm just intrigued, God. I'm intrigued. Let's have a dialogue. After all, you're my God. You're my friend. We can talk. How will this be? Just share with me. You know, how are you going to go about doing it? How will this be, Mary? Asked the angel. Since I am a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word, hallelujah, glory be to God, for no word from God will ever fail. Not only did God give explanation as to what was going to take place in terms of the process of how this is going to happen, but God also encouraged her, look, I've already done this before. Right now, somebody whom you know, that you're currently aware of, is 6 months already pregnant. Thirdly, I want to tell you something. Any word from God can never fail. So if I'm saying this to you, if God is delivering this word to you, it's already done. Even though you don't have the physical manifestation yet, it's already done. Why? Because everything that God does, it says, happens first in the spirit realm before we see the manifestation. It's our faith that brings about what is done in the spirit into the natural realm. Now, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, in verse 35, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Verse 36, even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. In other words, Elizabeth was said she can't conceive. People were saying there's no way Elizabeth can give birth to a child. People believe there's no way that can happen. But those who believe it was impossible, God was saying, look, not only is it possible, she's already halfway through, more than halfway through a pregnancy. So Mary, be encouraged. If I can do it for her, I can do it for you. For no, verse 37, for no word from God will ever fail. Now, this is the beautiful part of this scripture. Verse 38, Mary's response was this. She said, I am the Lord's servant. Mary answered, may your word to me be fulfilled. Hallelujah. This is powerful. Mary said, I am the Lord's servant. Now, tell me something. How on earth would she say, I am the Lord's servant, if she was not able to discern the voice of God? If she didn't believe in the ways that God works, if she didn't have an understanding of how God works sometimes, she said, I am the Lord's servant, meaning I believe your word, meaning I receive your word, meaning I hear your word, meaning I know you can do it, meaning I believe you're going to do it, meaning I submit myself to your will, and I thank you for your word, and I'm going with the plan. I am the Lord's servant, meaning whatever my flesh might say or people might say is irrelevant. Your word is forever established in heaven and on earth, and your word that you've spoken, I submit to it. That's why she said, I am the Lord's servant. I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. Hallelujah. If Mary wasn't able to discern the voice of God, she would struggle to submit to the instruction given to her by God. And if she had struggled to submit to the instruction given to her by God, guess what? She would have missed God. And this is how many Christians miss God. This is how many Christians miss God, because God tells you something, speaks to you, and what he's telling you sounds so far-fetched, sounds so extraordinary, sounds so pretty much out there, sounds like something only a superhuman can do, and we completely just ignore it or discard it because we are thinking with our own natural senses. We're not reminded. In fact, to be honest with you, I think that's a form of pride. When God speaks to you to do something about, so when God gives you a word and asks you to do something that seems a little bit out there or extraordinary, and we're thinking that can't be God because that's such a big thing. Not only are we limiting God, but we're basically thinking to ourselves that whatever God's going to tell us to do, we can do it. We have got the power to make it happen. We've got the skill set to make it happen. No. God will always instruct you to do things that he will give you the grace to do. God does not call you to do things that you can do without him. He calls you to do things that you will need his help to accomplish it. That's why the Bible tells us that we are co-laborers with God. We are co-laborers, meaning we are working hand in hand with God. It's not something that you're going to do by yourself. Why? Because the God has made it very clear. My glory I will share with no man. So what God's going to help you to fulfill, He would help you to do it, meaning you're not required to do it by yourself, because you need the grace of God to make it happen. You need the power of God in your life. You need the intervention of God to bring it to pass. That's why God has called you to be a co-laborer with him. Now, how can you be a co-laborer with God if you cannot hear the voice of God, if you cannot communicate with God? How can you work with God to accomplish a task that God wants you to accomplish if you cannot hear or discern his voice? It's not going to work. For you to work with God to fulfill your life purpose, or the purpose that God has for your life, you must be able to hear his voice, because he has some instructions for you. He has some things to teach you. He has the map, the roadmap, and he knows how to tell you which way to go. You know, he wants to tell you which way to go, how to do it. Just like he told Noah, this is how you should build the ark. This is the measurement for the ark. This is what you should do with the ark. This is how you should build the windows. This is the time you should shut the door. Very specific. And now understand this. If Noah had ignored those instructions, we will not be alive today, because Noah would have perished in the sea. In the flood, rather. He would have perished in the flood if he didn't follow the instruction that God gave him. That is why it's important to be able to discern the voice of God. So to summarize this, the first other way in which God speaks that I've explained to you, as we can see in scripture, is through angels. God speaks through angels. We've read that in the life of Zechariah, when an angel Gabriel appeared to him. We've read that when angel Gabriel appeared to Mary as well. God spoke to Zechariah through an angel. God spoke to God spoke to Mary through an angel as well. One acted in faith, which was Mary. One acted in disbelief, which was Zechariah. But nevertheless, the fact remains, God spoke through an angel. So God can speak through an angel. But I want to remind you this. Don't wait for an angel to appear to you before you believe God has spoken. No. Under our dispensation of grace, God will primarily speak through his word and through our spirit. Because the Holy Spirit lives inside of us, and the Holy Spirit is one with God, and our born-again spirit is one with the Holy Spirit and one with God. So God has no need to send an angel to speak to us. The reason why God sent an angel back in the olden days, in the Old Testament days, was because they were without the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came upon them, empowered them to do a specific task, and off it goes again. But we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, which means it never leaves us. We have creation power inside of us. It never leaves us. We have the grace of God inside of us. It never leaves us. All we need to do is learn to hear what the Spirit is saying to us so we can act on it. The Bible tells us, do not be hearers of the word only and deceive yourself, but be doers of the word. That's why when Jesus ascended back to heaven, he told the disciples, do not go and do anything. Wait for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Because that's what will empower you to do what you have to do. It was the Holy Spirit that told them where to go and preach, how to preach, and how to deliver the word. And it's the Holy Spirit that helped them to perform the miracles that they were performing. But guess what? They would not have been able to do any miracles if they weren't listening to what the Holy Spirit was instructing them to do. Jesus himself was reliant on the Holy Spirit when he was on earth. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who is God in the bodily form of man, was dependent on the Holy Spirit to do the works that he did. What did he say? He said, I only do what I see my Father do. So it's of crucial importance that we learn how to discern the voice of God, because in his voice is instruction. In his voice is guidance. In his voice is confidence. Now, the second way in which God speaks that I want to share with you today is this. And this is one way in which God speaks that a lot of people miss, but it's equally as important. God speaks through circumstances. God speaks through circumstances. I want to open the Bible to the book of Jonah chapter 1. Please type that into the box, please. Jonah chapter 1, I'm going to read from verse 1 to 17. Jonah chapter 1, I'm going to read from verse 1 to 17. Please type that into the chat box, please. Jonah chapter 1, verse 1 to 17. And it reads, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. It went down to Joppa, where it found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, it went abroad and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish." Verse 7, then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lots fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all these troubles for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked him, "What have you done? What should we do to you to make the sea calm for us? To calm down for us? Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to the land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, Lord, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man, for you, Lord, have done as you pleased." Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Here we see something very interesting. A word was given to a man of God, Jonah, which God told him to go and preach at the city. God had a specific task for him, but he disobeyed. And because of his disobedience, God used circumstances of life to prove to him that it is me talking to you, and I want you to do what I've instructed you to do. How do I know? We see here that there was a huge storm. Things weren't going well for him. He was on the journey going to where he wanted to go to, not where God wants him to go to, going to where he wanted to go to. And there was a huge storm, which gave the people around him unrest, even though he was busy sleeping. But there was a huge storm which got in the way of his journey, which completely got in the way of his journey and stopped him dead in his tracks. Sometimes in life, we believe that we know the answer to what we should do. We believe that we have all the answers. The Bible says there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to destruction. You see, in life, there's so many ways that seems right. There's so many things that seems right. There's so many things that appears lovely, that appears wonderful, that appears, even, should I say this, God sent. But not many are God sent. Not many are lovely. Not many are beautiful. Not many are the right path. But there's only one path that's right, and that's following the path of God. But you cannot follow the path of God if you cannot hear the instructions of God, and if you're not willing to follow his instructions. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. When you're God's sheep, God is saying he knows you, and he says you follow him. Jonah was God's sheep, but he was a rebellious sheep. And in this process of him, in the process of his rebellion, God used the circumstances of life, i.e. the wind, the storm, the waves, the sea, to get him back on track. Sometimes we are so far away from God, heading towards destruction, because God is all-knowing. He can see the end from the beginning, and God is speaking to us, "Don't go, do this, do that," but we're not listening, because God loves us so much. The Bible says, "He who God loves, he corrects." God can use the circumstances of life to speak to us. He can use the circumstances of life to bring you back to your senses. It can use the circumstances of life to bring you back to where you ought to be, even though those circumstances might take you through a process where there are consequences for your disobedience. So, for example, God could be saying to you, stop smoking, stop smoking, stop smoking, but you're not listening. But God can allow you to experience a poor health. Not that God will put that upon you. God can allow the devil to do what he has to do to pull poor health on you through your bad behavior. And in that sickness, and you going through that process of sickness, going through that process of pain in your sickness, going through that process of anguish in your sickness, going through that process of this, of feeling like you're not healthy, of feeling like you're about to die, or just knowing that you're suffering from a poor health. That could be a journey that God will allow you to go through. It doesn't matter how much you pray. Doesn't mean God is not listening to your prayer. Remember, God knows best. Sometimes we pray and wonder why God hasn't answered. It's not that he doesn't want to answer your prayer. He knows what's best for you. Sometimes we have what we want from God, but God knows what is best. The Bible says, will a man give you, would a man ask for bread, and would you ask God for bread, and would you give him stone? God forbid. The Bible says, will your child ask you for bread, and would you give him stone? No. So if we sinners know how to give good gifts to our children because we love them, how much more would God give us because he loves us? God loves us, so he's always going to give us the best. He's always going to act in our best interest, even if that means it involves us going through a process that might not be favorable. Even if that means it involves us going through a process that might not be nice. God's not interested in you feeling, God's not interested in so much in you feeling comfortable all the time. God is not interested in you feeling comfortable all the time. He's more interested in you growing, learning, being the best that you can be. And sometimes for you to be the best that you can be, God can allow you to go through certain circumstances that are not pleasurable, that are not nice, that don't feel good, but for the greater good. The Bible says, for it is he who walks in you. It is God who works in you. So sometimes I believe God puts us through what I call a spiritual gym. Now in a spiritual gym, you're either in a gym to lose weight, gain some muscles, or to stay fit. The reason why people go to a gym is for three main reasons. Number one, to gain some muscles, to lose weight, or to keep fit. Now, there is such a thing as a spiritual gym. Now, God sometimes allows us to go through what I call a spiritual gym, because in that gym, you never know whether you're there to lose weight. You never know whether you're there to gain some muscles. Knowing whether you're there to keep fit, but you will know for sure why you were there when you come out of the gym. You see, when you go into the gym, you might have your own ideas on why you're going to the gym, but your ideas might not be exactly why the reason why you're in the gym. So in the gym, you might be there to gain muscles. In the gym, you might be there to lose weight. In that gym, you might be there to keep fit, but you will never know for sure until you come out of that gym. And that is what God does. Because we look at the life of Jonah, for example, as we read on in the story here, when Jonah was thrown into the water, God arranged a whale to swallow him up. And obviously that meant he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days. Now, can you imagine, just picture this, try to imagine what he went through in the belly of a whale. Here was a man who was sleeping on the boat comfortably, even though there was a storm, he was comfortable in the boat. But now he's in the belly of a whale, which means water's coming in. You're trying to sleep, whoosh, water. You're trying to sleep, whoosh, water. Maybe you're trying to sleep and it goes slap in the face with a fish. Or maybe you're trying to sleep and the fish comes and pokes you. Why? Because the whale is constantly taking things in. And can you imagine that just being in the belly of a whale, everything the whale eats gets poured upon you. But the grace of God kept him alive. So you might go through certain circumstances in life, they're not favorable, they're not pleasant, they might be hard, they might be painful, because you're going through a process due to your disobedience, or you're going through a process that God knows you need to go through in order for you to produce something in you that's more beneficial, that will lead you to your destiny, that will make you who He's called you to be, that will lead you in the right path, that will be a blessing to you. At the time of you going through your trials and tribulations, you might not see it that way. You might wonder, oh, God has abandoned me, God has left me, you know, God doesn't care about me. But in the long run, it's more beneficial for you. In the long run, you look back and say, God, I thank you for allowing me to go through that. Because now you have a better perception. Now that you've come out of that gym, you can see, looking back, why you had to go through that gym. And you can now see what you've gained by going to that gym. Everybody wants a great body, but nobody wants to put in the work. But just like in the gym, to get the body you want, to get the health that you want, to get the fitness that you want, you must be willing to go through the process. Now, sometimes, depending on how mature you are in God, you can voluntarily, you know, put yourself in the gym, or God can put you in the gym. But going into the gym is a must. Every Christian must go into the gym, what I call the spiritual gym. You either go in by yourself, or you go in by pain. You see, everybody must serve God. You must serve God either by pain or by pleasure. What I mean by that is this. You either be drawn to God because of the pain and challenge of life that you faced, or you're drawn away from God because of the pain and challenge of life that you faced, or you're drawn to God because of the pleasure and the blessing that He's providing you with. But there is no blessing, there's no gain without process. God wants to bless you and I. And in fact, the Bible tells us He's blessed us with all heavenly blessings. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 3, I believe, tells that God has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Let me say that again. The Bible tells us that God has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. So when we pray to God, we shouldn't pray, God bless me, God bless me, God bless me. That's the wrong prayer. How can you pray, God bless me, when God's already given you, and He's already blessed you with everything that pertains to life and godliness? So what you need to live this Christian life successfully and to grow and mature in your Christian life, God has blessed you with already. What you need to live your natural life successfully and to grow and to flourish in your natural life, God has blessed you with already. Because the Bible tells me in 1 Peter 2 verse 3, God has blessed you with everything that pertains to what? Life and godliness. So you're lacking nothing but the application of what God has blessed you with. So your prayer should be, God, help me retrieve what you've blessed me with and let it manifest in my life. Not, God bless me, it's already blessed you. The two types of prayer God will not answer. Number one, that's a prayer of lack of faith, and a prayer asking God to do what He's already done. Let me say that again. The two types of prayer that God will not answer. Number one, that is a prayer that has lack of faith in it, and a prayer asking God to do what He's already done. So sometimes people might say, but I prayed, I fasted, but nothing's happened. Let me say something. Sometimes when God is silent, that's God speaking. God speaks in silence. But I'm not going to go into that today. I'll go into that next few weeks down the line. But that's another way in which God speaks. He speaks in silence. God's silence is God speaking. But I'm not going to get into that today because that's a deep subject to go into. But I want you to understand this. There are two types of prayer that God will not answer. That's a prayer that has lack of faith in it, and a prayer that involves you asking God to do what He's already done. Now, moving on from there, we've seen how God speaks today. God speaks through angel. We saw that in the life of Mary. God speaks through angels. We saw that in the life of Zechariah. And now we've seen the second way in which God speaks, which I'm just sharing just two ways today. And next week we'll continue with two other ways in which God speaks. God speaks through circumstances. We see Jonah was told to do a particular thing, to go and preach to in a particular city. He disobeyed. Circumstances of life came. He experienced the circumstances of life, which was the storms and the waves of life. And that got him to a place of what we call godly sorrow. And in that godly sorrow, he repented and did exactly what God has told him to do. And everything worked quite well for him. Now, it's not that God was dictating it. It's not that God was trying to control his life. No, God had a plan for his life. God had a purpose for his life. You see, the purpose that God has for your life is of great importance to God. That God would use anything to bring your attention to it. God will use anything to bring your attention to it. I'll give an example. Moses, God spoke to Moses through a burning bush. I'm sure God had been trying to get his attention all this while, but he wasn't getting it. So God did something dramatic. God spoke to Balaam through a donkey. I'm sure God's been trying to get his attention all this while, but he wasn't listening. So God had to do something dramatic. And this is what God does. When God has a purpose for your life, He will move heaven and earth to bring you to attention of that purpose. That's one thing God will do. He will move heaven and earth. He will use the forces of the wind. He will use the forces of the universe to bring your attention to that purpose. And then once your attention is zoned in on that purpose, He allows you to make a decision. So now with Jonah, God spoke to him, he wasn't getting it. God tried this, he wasn't getting that. Did his own thing. God sent the waves. God sent the waves, the ocean, the sea, you know, all of that. The forces of life to speak to him that, look, Jonah, I'm trying to get attention. Jonah, just like imagine when you got a kid. Just like imagine when you have a child. You know, don't do that. Don't put your hand in that thing. Doesn't listen. Don't put your hand in that thing. Doesn't listen. Don't put your hand in that thing. Doesn't listen. Eventually, when it does again, you smack the child. Why? Because you're trying to bring the child's attention to something that's of great importance that will help them in the future. So this is how God speaks. God speaks through angels. But please, I'm begging you, don't wait for angels to appear before you hearken to the voice of God. That is the exception, not the rule. Under our dispensation of grace, angels appearing to you, giving you a word from God, is an exception, not the rule. The rule is God will speak to you primarily through his word. That's why we have the word. Remember, David, Moses, they didn't have the word of God. They didn't have the Holy Spirit. That's why God spoke to them mainly through angels and through the audible voice. Now, can God speak through audible voices today? Yes, it can. But that's not the primary way in which God speaks. God has spoken to me once through an audible. I've heard the voice of God audibly once in my life. Since I've been a Christian, I've only heard the voice of God audibly once in my life. I hear the voice of God on a daily basis. But I've heard the voice of God audibly once in my life. So imagine I was just waiting for the audible voice. That means I will only believe God spoke to me ever, only once. No, but I hear God speak to me. He speaks to me daily. But I've only heard the audible voice of God once in my life. So please don't wait for, and I've never seen an angel, only in a dream. So don't wait for an angel for you to believe God speaking to you. You need to learn the different ways in which God speaks. And you need to keep constantly train yourself to be able to discern how he speaks. And when you've learned the different ways in which God speaks, because in this series I'm going to cover 10. So far I've covered six, including today's two topics. So two different ways in which God speaks that I've covered today. That makes it six. And we've got four more ways to go. Because there's 10 I've discovered so far in my experience and from studying the word of God. But despite me knowing 10 ways in which God speaks, I'm not limiting myself to just 10. Because I'm sure if I meet other men of God or anybody else, the other people will be able to teach me different ways in which God speaks as well, because they've had different experiences. So the key thing is not to limit God to how you've discovered he speaks to you or what you've read and on how he speaks. It's to consistently keeping yourself open to how he speaks. And the best way for you to keep yourself open to how God speaks is to develop a systematic desire to get closer to him on a daily basis, because the closer you get to God, the easier it will become for you to discern the different ways he speaks. Because the reason why you will be able to discern the different way God speaks is this: if your mom was to speak, if your parent or your brother or your sister, whatever works for you, maybe brother, sister, or mom, was to speak to you through a megaphone, you would discern their voice. If your brother or your mom or your dad was to speak to you through a London bus, you can hear the voice. If they were to shout from a tall building, you can discern their voice. Why? Because you're familiar. Because you're familiar with the voice. You are in relationship with them, so you can discern their voice. Now, if you were to call me on the phone, and I know you, and I have a relationship with you, I can discern your voice. Now, if your dad or your mom was to call me on the phone, I can hear a voice, but I cannot discern it to be the voice of your dad or your mom or your sister or your brother or your cousin. Why? Because I'm not in relationship with them. Let me say that again. If your brother was to call me on the phone, I can discern a voice, but I would not be able to discern that as your brother's voice if I'm not in relationship with your brother. In other words, if I don't have a relationship with your brother, if I've never spoken to your brother before, if I've never spoken to your dad before, if I've never spoken to your mom before, and they were to ring me on the phone, how can I discern that is your mom or dad? I can't, because there's no point of reference. But if I'm in relationship with them, if I've gotten to know them, if I've spent time with them, if I've talked with them, if I've hung around them enough, then I'll be able to discern that's their voice. That is exactly how it works with God. You can hear his voice. Born-again Christian will hear his voice. A non-born-again Christian will hear the voice of God. But you can only discern the voice of God if you are in relationship with Him. That's why Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice. They know me. I know them, and they follow me." You cannot follow a voice you don't discern. You cannot follow a voice you don't trust. It starts with trust, and you will not trust somebody you don't have a relationship with. You just wouldn't. As human beings, we don't trust people we don't have a relationship with. It could be a distant relationship. It could be a mutual relationship through friends and family. But there must be a level of relationship for there to be trust. Trust is only created when you have a foundation of relationship in place. So God has invited you and I into a relationship with Him. And the reason why God sent Jesus to die for us is because He knew for us to be able to walk with Him and have a relationship with Him, we have to be able to hear His voice. We have to be able to communicate with Him. And for that to happen, we need to deal with the sin issue. Hence the reason why He sent Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to die for us to get rid of the sin issue. The Bible says in the book of John that when John saw Jesus, John said something very profound. When John the Baptist saw Jesus, remember John was sent by God to make the way for the Messiah. But when John saw Jesus, he said something very profound. John said this, he said, "Behold, here comes the Lamb of God, which takes away sin." That is a profound statement. He said, "Behold, here comes the Lamb of God, which takes away sin." Now, before Jesus came, notice this. When men sinned, every year the priests would go to the temple. They'll get goats and ram. They'll offer sacrifices to God, and they'll kill the goats. And the fire will come from heaven, consume the offering, consume the sacrifice, and their sins will be forgiven for another year. So everybody who sinned that whole year, once a year they'll go to the temple. The priests would obviously offer their sacrifices that they've brought to God, present it before the altar of God. Fire will come from heaven to consume the sacrifice. And the fire coming from heaven represents forgiveness of their sins, which meant they have 1 year license, you know, to be covered by God. So they've got 1 year, they've got a 1 year grace period with God, because now you've offered sacrifices, fire's consumed it, you know. So that's what used to happen. But that did not take away the sin issue. Why? Because every year they had to do the same thing again. So next year they come back again, they offer another goat, another bull, fire comes down from heaven, consume the sacrifices, and off they go. And next year they come back again, fire consume the lamb or whatever they brought to the altar, and off they go again. But that did not deal with the sin issue. But when Jesus came to die, it dealt with the sin issue. No longer do we have to offer the blood of goats and rams for our sins. All we have to do is accept Him as our Lord and Savior, because He paid the sin debt in full. That's why John the Baptist said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away sin." In other words, He's dealing with the sin issue. He's dealt with the sin issue. So please understand this. Hearing the voice of God and discerning the voice of God is crucially important in order to develop your walk with God. "My sheep hear my voice. They know me and they follow me." So if you're born again or not, you hear the voice of God. But unless you're in a relationship with God, you cannot discern His voice. So today we've covered God speaks through angels and God speaks through circumstances. So sometimes when you go through things in life, don't be quick to blame God. Don't be quick to wonder why God allowed this. Think beyond that. What is God trying to communicate to me? Is God trying to communicate me, and what is He trying to communicate to me? I hope that's been helpful. My name is, please share this page. Type in all the scriptures we've quoted today into the comment box. We looked at Luke chapter 1 let me just put that up again. We looked at Luke chapter 1 verse 8 to 19. Please put that in the comment section. We looked at Luke chapter 1 verse 26 to 38. Please put that in the comment section as well and share this page. I hope that's been very helpful to you. Please, any questions you have, feel free to inbox me and I'll be more than happy to discuss that with you. And next week I'm going to be covering two other ways in which God speaks. But for tonight, I'd like to say thank you for watching. I hope this blessed you. Share this page. Put your comments in the comment section and I'll speak to you soon. Have a fantastic evening. This is Pastor Shay from M.I.C. Church, and I'll speak to you soon. Bye-bye.